people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Pratiksha Mishra with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's first talk about India and Brazil, which are significantly enhancing their strategic partnership through high-level meetings and increased collaboration. Recent discussions and visits have underscored their commitment to deepening bilateral and multilateral ties. Here's a closer look at the latest developments in their evolving relationship.
India and Brazil maintain a deep and diverse relationship, both bilaterally and within larger multilateral organizations like the UN and UNESCO. Since becoming strategic partners in 2006, their relationship has been built on a shared global vision, mutual democratic values, and a joint commitment to promoting economic growth with social inclusion for the benefit of their populations. Recently, India's External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar co-chaired the 9th India-Brazil Joint Commission with his Brazilian counterpart Mauro Vieira in New Delhi. During the meeting, both sides took stock of bilateral ties, including cooperation in trade, defense, energy, health, agriculture, space and technology. They also exchanged views on global geopolitical developments, the shared concerns and aspirations of the Global South. The India-Brazil Joint Commission meeting, which takes place every 2 years, is a crucial forum for the two countries to assess the progress of their bilateral collaboration and to plan future diplomatic and economic strategies. During the meeting, both ministers explored strategies to boost trade and investment, advance technological collaboration, and strengthen connections between the scientific communities of the two countries.
We have a substantial bilateral trade basket. It has, by and large, gone up. In the last year, we've had some challenges. It's something I look forward to discussing with you. We also have a very important energy cooperation between our two countries. And we, of course, particularly value the biofuels cooperation that India and Brazil have established.
The visit by Brazilian Foreign Minister Mauro Vieira was a key moment for deepening the strategic partnership that was first established in 2006 and for exploring new areas of collaboration across bilateral, regional, and multilateral domains. This visit was particularly timely given the evolving global geopolitical landscape as both India and Brazil work through the challenges of a shifting world order. Highlighting the strong and expanding partnership between Brazil and India, Foreign Minister Mauro Vieira emphasized that the cooperation between the two countries is growing across various important sectors, including digital governance, bioenergy, agriculture, and defense.
Brazil and India's strategic partnership has promoted a fast-growing cooperation in many sectors. Over the last few years, there has been a significant expansion of our bilateral agenda, incorporating promising areas such as digital governance, bioenergy, agriculture, and defense, to name only a few. Despite the challenges posed by the current international scenario, our trade flows have been steadily growing, having reached $12 billion last year.
As India and Brazil continue to build on their strategic partnership through these high-level engagements and cooperative initiatives. They are setting a strong example of international collaboration. The defense relationship between India and Brazil is particularly noteworthy, marked by extensive collaboration across multiple domains. The Indian Navy collaborates with its Brazilian counterpart through a range of initiatives, including operational interactions, joint training, and other maritime efforts. The recent visit of Admiral Olsen, commander of the Brazilian Navy, to India was aimed at enhancing maritime cooperation between the two countries. It also served to highlight the shared commitment of their navies to address common challenges in maritime security.
Chile and India are deepening their partnership as they mark 75 years of diplomatic relations. Recent discussions between Chilean Foreign Minister and Indian Minister of External Affairs have highlighted their shared commitment to global issues such as climate change and UNSC reform. Both nations are also focusing on critical areas like trade, investment and resource collaboration, with India planning delegation to explore lithium and copper resources in Chile. A report.
India and South American country Chile maintain a robust and amicable relationship characterized by shared viewpoints on numerous global issues. Chile is aligned with India's concerns regarding international terrorism and has consistently condemned the cross-border terrorism experienced by India. The two nations collaborate closely in multilateral forums, sharing common perspectives on climate change, renewable energy, and the reform and expansion of the UN Security Council. In 2003, Chile voiced its support for India's aspiration to secure a permanent seat on the UNSC, and this support has remained steadfast. On August 27, Chilean Foreign Minister Alberto Juan Claverin held bilateral discussions with Indian Minister of External Affairs S. Jaishankar. During the second joint commission meeting between the two countries, S. Jaishankar expressed gratitude to Chile for its continued backing of India's bid for a permanent UNSC membership.
We also thank you very much for your support for a permanent membership in the expanded Security Council.
In the joint commission meeting, S. Jaishankar and Alberto discussed several aspects of their bilateral relationship. Their conversation covered trade and investment, critical minerals, agriculture and defense. According to government officials, India will send two delegations to Chile to scout for lithium and copper resources to speed up the energy transition and stoke demand for critical minerals. On the social media platform X, Jaishankar expressed confidence that 75th anniversary of India-Chile relations will lead to an even stronger friendship between the two nations. Alberto also described the meeting as significant in the context of the anniversary.
Well, I think it's a very important partner for Chile. Really, we admire India for its growth, for its culture, for its civilization. And we think that there is a big potential to expand our ties with India. And precisely the purpose of this meeting, the Chile-India Summit 2024, is to strengthen our ties with India, both in economic terms and also in political terms.
Chilean Foreign Minister's visit underscored Santiago's dedication to strengthening its relationship with a major Asian economic power, emphasizing a mutual vision for increased collaboration across various sectors. By focusing on these collaborative opportunities, both nations aim to enhance their strategic partnership and achieve mutual benefits through strengthened economic and diplomatic relations.
Time now for Asia This Week, the stories from across the continent.
Iran's supreme leader, Ali Khamenei, who has imposed some of the strictest controls on internet access in the world, said on Tuesday that cyberspace needed to be regulated, citing the arrest of messaging app Telegram founder Pavel Durov in France as an example of how other countries also impose controls.
بر اساس قانون یه قانونی اگر ندارید قانون رو به وجود بیارید بر اساس اون قانون زمام کار رو به دست بگیرید همه دنیا این کارو میکنن میبینید دیگه این جوون بیچاره رو فرانسویا یعنی اینقدر تا این حد سختگیری انجام میگیره طرفو میگیرن زندان میکنن تهدید میکنن که 20 سال محکومیت به تو خواهیم داد این برخواد این است که حکمرانی اونا رو نقض کرده نقض حکمرانی قابل قبول نیست شما یک کشور در اختیار شماست که وظیفه در قبالش دارید
The Islamic Republic has some of the strictest internet controls in the world, but its blocks on US-based social media such as Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube are routinely bypassed by tech-savvy Iranians using virtual private networks. In a tragic incident, a bus carrying 43 Indian passengers plunged into the swollen Marsian Gadi River in Nepal, resulting in numerous fatalities. The bus, which was registered in India, was traveling from tourist destination of Pokhara to Nepali capital Kathmandu. Rescuers managed to retrieve several individuals from the floodwaters in Tanahun district, approximately 118 kilometers from Kathmandu. Police and military personnel descended using metal ladders and ropes to rescue both survivors and victims. Subsequently, an Indian Air Force plane was dispatched to transport deceased back to their hometowns. Russia's Vice Minister of Industry and Trade, Roman Chekhushov, held a meeting with North Korea's Minister of External Economic Relations, Yoon Jong-ho, on August 27 in Pyongyang. In video provided by North Korea's official news agency KCNA, Chekhushov and Yoon, along with other officials, sat down for talks at Mansude Assembly Hall. Chekhushov, who arrived in Pyongyang a day before with a Russian delegation, discussed further developing economic cooperation with North Korean officials. North Korea has dramatically upgraded its ties with Russia in the past year with two summit meetings between their leaders who pledged closer cooperation in all areas.
Let's now move to Pakistan, which saw widespread protests and a nationwide shutdown strike in response to soaring inflation and controversial tax reforms. Demonstrators burn electricity bills, highlighting their frustration with high energy costs and inadequate government actions on price controls. Traders voice strong opposition to the Tajir Dost scheme, a new tax reform introduced earlier this year, which they argue adds to their financial burdens without addressing systematic issues. Take a look.
On August 28, Pakistan experienced a nationwide shutdown strike as people across various cities protested against rising inflation. Demonstrations erupted in several urban centers where protesters burned their electricity bills and voiced concerns about exorbitant charges. The high cost of electricity, coupled with government's inability to lower prices or reduce additional taxes, has severely impacted those struggling to make ends meet. Opposition parties such as Jamiat Ulema-e-Islam Fazl, Jamaat-e-Islami and the Awami National Party voiced their support for the aggrieved traders. In response to the traders' associations, strike call, businesses across the country, including major cities like Karachi and Lahore, remained closed, demonstrating significant community solidarity with the protest.
ताजरों पे रहम करें वरना हम ये पहिया जाम भी करेंगे और हम इनके घिरे बानों तक भी पहुंचेंगे। वो दिन दूर नहीं अगर ये ताज ये जो हुकूमत है वक्त है इसने ये होश के नाखून ना लिए, आईएमएफ की गुलामी बंद ना की और ये जो जबराना टैक्सेस हैं, ये ताजर टैक्स ये नहीं है कि देना नहीं चाहते, लेकिन ये टैक्स उतना लेना नहीं चाहते जितना हम देना चाहते हैं। ये अपनी मर्जी से अपनी अयाशियों के टैक्स भी हम ताजरों से लेना चाहते हैं, जिसकी आज हमने हड़ताल की है और मजम्मत कर रहे हैं।
Traders across Pakistan voiced their frustration with reforms designed to expand the tax base in the financially strained country. Their protests were specifically directed at the Tajir Dost scheme with the Federal Board of Revenue implemented in March of this year. According to reports, the goal of the scheme is to improve tax collection and ensure that more economic activities are captured in the tax net. However, the scheme has faced criticism and resistance from traders who argue that it imposes additional burdens and does not adequately address their concerns about the tax system.
हमारी किसी से कोई जाती लड़ाई नहीं, हमारी लड़ाई इस सिस्टम के खिलाफ है जो घर में बैठकों में बैठ के फैसले कर देते हैं। तो मैं ताजरों को दावत देता हूं कि आए हमारे साथ खड़े हो जाएं, हम आप हमें वोट देकर ताकत दें, हम आपकी आवाज बनेंगे इंशाल्लाह। आपके हकूक के लिए आपके भाई हम ताजरों वाले बाजारों में मौजूद हैं, जो तकलीफ में आप हैं हम भी उसी में मुब्तला हैं, तो इंशाल्लाह कोशिश करेंगे कि आपकी इन तकलीफ का अजाला करें।
इन पाकिस्तान द राइजिंग कॉस्ट ऑफ लिविंग हैज बिकम अ सिग्निफिकेंट कंसर्न विद इन्फ्लेशन driving up prices for essentials like food, fuel and medical care. The surge in costs is straining household budgets and diminishing purchasing power, making it increasingly difficult for many people to afford basic necessities. Contributing to this economic instability are fluctuating global commodity prices, supply chain disruptions and domestic economic policies, compounded by the devaluation of the Pakistani rupee, which raises the cost of imported goods. The impact is most severe on lower income and middle class families who spend a larger share of their income on essentials, leading to heightened financial stress and a diminished quality of life.
Let's now turn our attention to Pakistan-occupied Gilgit-Baltistan, where villages surrounding Skardu are facing critical challenges in infrastructure and healthcare. Despite their proximity to the renowned Satpara Lake, villages like Satpara struggle with poor road conditions, inconsistent electricity, and the lack of a fully operational civil dispensary. This deficiency in medical services has resulted in tragic consequences, including the recent deaths of two newborns. Locals report frequent closures and severe understaffing at the dispensary, which compounds their difficulties. Here's the closer look at the situation.
Villages surrounding Skardu city in Pakistan-occupied Gilgit-Baltistan have been facing severe hardships due to inadequate infrastructure and a shortage of basic facilities. Satpara, a village located near Satpara Lake, just a few kilometers from Skardu district, is grappling with significant infrastructural issues, particularly concerning the lack of a civil dispensary. Despite numerous complaints to the authorities, residents continue to face lack of essential services. Although Satpara is situated near the picturesque Satpara Lake, a major tourist attraction in POGB, it remains deprived of basic amenities like a dispensary, proper roads, infrastructure and electricity.
कल जो सतपारा के सिविल डिस्पेंसरी के हवाले से हमने जो इशू उठाया था वो जीनियन इशू है, हकीकी इशू है, जिस पे हमने काफी मेहनत भी की है, आगे हम मिले भी हैं। यहाँ जो टेक्निकल स्टाफ की हमने बात की थी, तीन टेक्निकल स्टाफ सिविल डिस्पेंसरी में होते हैं, लेकिन यहाँ पे वाहिद एक डिस्पेंसर मौजूद है, ना एलएचबी है, ना कोई नर्सिंग स्टाफ यहाँ पे मौजूद है, कोई भी नहीं है। जो बाकी के स्टाफ जो नौ स्टाफ होते हैं उसमें से तीन स्टाफ यहाँ पे काम कर रहे हैं। वाहिद एक डिस्पेंसरी है जो कि बंद पड़ी हुई है। ये यहाँ के आवाम के साथ मजाक नहीं है तो क्या है? अगर हुकाम वाला इस पर नोटिस न ले, अब भी खामोशी की नींद सोते रहे तो जो बच्चे, दो बच्चे इसी माह अगस्त में डिलीवरी के दौरान फौत हुए, ये LSP के ना होने की वजह से, अगर यहाँ पे LSP होती तो ये दोनों बच्चे फौत ना होते।
The lack of adequate medical facilities has had tragic consequences. Recently, two newborn babies in Satpara died due to the lack of proper medical care, as the village lacks proper medical facilities. The ongoing issues in Gilgit-Baltistan underscore broader concerns about health facilities and basic services in the region, which has faced persistent difficulties since its occupation by Pakistan.
यहाँ पे सतपारा डिस्पेंसरी में हमेशा से दवाई का मसला रहा है। यहाँ पे ज़रूरत की जो दवाई होती है वो नहीं मिलती है, और जो तैनात डिस्पेंसर यहाँ पे लगाते हैं, मेरी तो ज़ाती उस पर बहुत सारी शिकायत हैं, कभी आते ही नहीं। हफ्ते में कोई 3 दफ़ा आते हैं, 5 दिन गायब रहते हैं, जब आते हैं तो 1 बजे वापस चले जाते हैं। तो हमारा ख्याल यही है, इस डिस्पेंसरी पर ख़ास तवज्जो दी जाए।
Pakistan's approach to the development of occupied region of Gilgit-Baltistan reveals a troubling pattern of neglect and insufficient investment. Despite its natural beauty, the region suffers from chronic underdevelopment due to the government's inadequate funding and slow policy implementation. Bureaucratic inefficiencies and a lack of effective local representation exacerbate these issues, leaving Gilgit-Baltistan feeling marginalized and disconnected from development efforts. This neglect not only stifles the region's potential but also undermines the well-being of its residents, highlighting a significant disparity between the government's development priorities and the needs of the local people in Gilgit-Baltistan.
Despite the severe challenges the local communities in POGB face, there's a concerning lack of government response. And with that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.